met a lot of people last night, and I've been a member of SIR since 1992. There are some people that I don't know, so I'll introduce myself in case you don't know me. My name's Howard Morenz. I'm the grandson of that gent up on the wall. I'm here to make an introduction to a gentleman that the family and I've known since 1977, as I recall. But his history of Howie Morenz predates that back into the 50s. And it's really, this presentation is about the creation of the book, the history behind it. And I would guess that it was started in the 1950s, Dean, that you first had your conversations with Dick Thorne, which was one of Howie Morenz's first coaches. And it led to an interest in my grandfather, and Dean had an interest in journalism. One of his first stories was written in the Mitchell Advocate in the early 1960s. He went on into education, got a BA in sociology, and the next time we saw him, I think, was when he was getting his Master of Arts in Journalism in 1977. He came to our home in Dollar Des Ormeaux in Quebec, and interviewed us as part of his thesis, which was a documentary film on my grandfather. And following that, he led into the first edition of the book, Howie Morenz, Hockey's First Superstar, in 1982. And the family was really quite pleased with the results of that book. And Dean had traveled extensively, did a lot of research on it, met with a lot of hockey greats, players, coaches, managers, and members of the media as well. 34 years later, you could ask why, and we'll try to account for that, a second edition came out. My involvement with some of these initiatives expanded from 1977 on. I was involved a little bit with the edition that was released in 2016. So again, Dean is going to present is his history of how the story evolved over time. I'd like to introduce Dean.
Thank you, Howie. I would just as soon do what Paul did this morning and just sort of yell and move. Is that all right? I didn't mean yelling. Working without a microphone. As Howie mentioned, my first contact with with anything to do with Howie Morenz happened when I was growing up in Mitchell, Ontario, which is about 12 miles west of Stratford. And we lived on Abbott Street, and across the road was a guy named W.C. Dick Thorne. In fact, this is real name Richard, but for Wilfred. For some reason, I think he was nicknamed after his father, Dick Thorne, and he had an immaculate lawn across the street. He ran a shoe store in Stratford, in Mitchell, rather, and he was our neighbor. I was a little goober living across the street, and I kind of got to know him, and occasionally he would tell me stories about a guy named Howie Morenz, and he would say, you know, this guy was a pretty good hockey player, and he grew up right here in Mitchell. And he piqued my interest enough that I went to the library, the Carnegie Library in Mitchell, and I started looking up this guy, Howie Morenz, and I could find little snippets about him in various publications, but never anything extensive. It was a word or two here, a line or two here, and so on. And it stayed like that for a while, and gradually, I guess even subconsciously, I gathered more information about him. And by the time I talked more to Dick Thorne as I got older, and I collected more stories from him, more information, I found photographs of teams that he played on in Mitchell and learned a little bit more about that and how the family eventually moved to Stratford and things like that. So in high school, the story that Howie's talking about the Mitchell Advocate, when I was in high school, I got interested in writing stuff. So I wrote local sports for some of the minor teams, and I wrote some high school sports, and the editor of the newspaper was happy to publish it. She was happy to get anything for her paper, and as written as it was, but that story sort of put me on this Howie Morenz trail. Interestingly enough, My English teachers at high school never mentioned it. My math teacher did. I have no idea, other than he must have been a hockey player, and the English teacher knew nothing about Howard Grant and maybe didn't care. So Dick Thorne was my first, was my introduction. Time passed. I got into the newspaper business, and then elected to do a graduate degree in journalism. Wound up at Western in 76, 77. To get out of there with the piece of paper, you had to come up with a project, and it could be either a print or broadcast. And I elected to do broadcast because I had worked in print for the Free Press and the Beacon Herald and Stratford. I was sort of interested in the broadcast side, but so I threw out a proposal of doing a documentary on Howie Morantz, and the faculty accepted that as a worthy project. And they said it would have to be at least 12 minutes long, this documentary. Didn't have the cameras that we have today. Had great big heavy duty VHS cameras that you probably remember seeing television guys carrying around like this, and heavy tripods and battery packs that didn't last very long. It was a cumbersome thing, but the school had that, and we were supposedly trained a little bit on that, so that we could go out and do interviews, and they taught us how to do some editing, you know, with the razor blade and the tape, putting it all together, and so supposedly we were able to do that. We also had a couple of good technicians in the program, who probably saved most of our bacon. I was 20-some years old. I loved hockey, in particular the Montreal Canadiens. And that really didn't come from knowing anything about Morantz. It just sort of happened in our family. My brother and I became Habs fans. It predated, of course, anything that had to do with the internet and email. So I tracked down a whole number of people that I thought could maybe contribute. I don't know if I would have been bold enough to do it today, but I did it back then. A number of people that I thought would maybe help me with this, and I started writing letters. I sat down and I typed out letters and sent them off to various and sundry people, and wound up setting up a bit of a schedule that I could interview these people in various places, and recruited a couple of my buddies who worked, had nothing to do with the journalism. And said, would you like to do a road trip to Toronto? Would you like to do a road trip to Montreal? This is what we're going to do. And they signed on, and away we went. In Stratford, I was able to talk to a guy named Tom Dolan, who was a newspaper man when Howie Morantz was playing junior hockey. The family moved from Stratford from Mitchell to Stratford when he was about 14 years old. He was born in 02. They moved there because the father got a job with what else but the railway. And he played some junior hockey. They didn't have senior at the time, did some intermediate. So he played some junior, some intermediate, and also played for the railway team. He eventually got a job with the railway as well in Stratford. Some would say that he did more sleeping with the railway than he did playing, working, because he would curl up in locomotives that were being repaired. So we had a huge locomotive repair facility in Stratford. And he would curl up in the locomotive to sleep because he was playing three and four and five times a week with the times three of the team. So anyway, I found out soon after I was in Stratford that his sister was in Bertie Bushfield. Went down and made an acquaintance with her, and she was gracious. She told me a lot of family information. Started sending letters off, got some replies back, and planned these trips. Went down to New Hamburg and interviewed guys like guy who was a doctor by then, had played with Morantz when he was at Mitchell, a guy named Amy Letterman as well, Eddie Kalflesh, interviewed them. Then we had to go farther afield, and the first trip was in February, first weekend in February in 1977, down to Toronto. And I'd already talked to Lefty Reed at the Hall of Fame, which of course then was at the C&E rooms, and Lefty was all gung-ho to help me on whatever we wanted to do. We went down and saw him. Had an interview lined up with Ace Bailey, and so we went around to his apartment, I guess you call it a condo now maybe, and there he was living by himself in this place, and he met us at the door, neatly dressed, the tie, the shirt, just a truly a gentleman. I'm sure there are people to my way of thinking, just the same. He led us into his place. We set up all this equipment in his living room, and we had the interview with him, and it was terrific. At that time, he was a gold judge. He was one of the gold judges that made the tournament. So he was going down to the game that Saturday night. He said to us, "Are you going to the ring?" And I said, "Well, we are, because I had lined up an interview with King Clancy." And I said, "We're going to be down on the Saturday." And he said, "Can you come down to the rink and we'll do it before the game?" "Okay, sure, we can do that." So Bailey was going to the game, we were going to the game, and we went into Maple Leaf Gardens, and they had the guys doing the check-in and the walkthrough and stuff. And I just sort of leaned across and I said, we're here to see King Clancy. Just a minute, he disappears into the back of the office. And he comes out, and King sees us standing there with the equipment, and just goes like this. So the gate swung open, and in we walked, and he says, "Hi, little boys," and, you know, typical Irish good humor and everything. And he welcomed us like we were long lost cousins, and he'd never seen us before. So where do you want to do this? You know, there were people filing into the ring. I said, "Well, we've got someplace that's quiet." He said, "Yeah, we can find some spots." We walked down into the bowels of the gardens, and we come to a room underneath some of the seats in the grandstand. He opens the door, and we walk in. It's not a very big room, really, not a very big room at all. There's a desk in there, and a couple of chairs, and pipes, big heavy pipes running through the ceiling, and the room is obviously, you know, slanted, like the roof line is slanted. And so we got it all set up. He said, "Boys, ask me anything you want." So we interviewed King, and he was as colorful as he ever was. He was just some of the lines he's used before, you know, so fast he did stop in a dime and maybe 9 cents change and all of this. He was great. He was terrific. And then he says, in the middle of the interview, though, we're right in the middle of it, the door opens. Again, this is not a big room. The door opens. In walks George Armstrong. He goes, oh. King gets up, he introduces us to George, and he stuffed it just in against us. So I don't know whether it was the Marleys room. It may have been, because Armstrong at the time was coaching the Marleys. He walks in and he gets introduced, and he continues around the corner, got something, and left. And that's fine. The interview ends, and two things happen. We're just cleaning up or getting all our stuff together, and there was a sitting on a table almost this big was a tank, an empty tank. It looked like an aquarium, an empty aquarium with a gable on it, with this high, big thing. And I watched this thing, you know, when we were setting up, and in fact, we were careful we didn't set anything against it. And I said, is this really an aquarium? He says, yeah, it is. I said, what, nobody uses it? Well, Ballard used to keep piranha in there. But every time Shaq would walk by, he'd try to catch one with his hands. And he says, Ballard figured it was easier to get rid of the fish than to get rid of Shaq if he had only one hand. So the second thing that happened was King says, are you boys going to stay for the game? I remember this is 76-77. They had a fierce rivalry going with Philadelphia at the time. Those were the, you know, knocking down Red Club days with the Flyers and the Leafs, just the way Boston and the Habs were doing pretty well in the same season. And I said, "Well, no, we don't have any tickets." "Oh, you got to stay for the game." I said, "But we don't have any tickets." I said, "Don't worry about that." He says, "You want to leave your stuff here?" I said, "It's okay to leave it here." He says, sure. He says, "Now I got to get over to the brewery this one." He says, "You go out here," he takes us back out towards the lobby, and he says, "You know how to get up to the press box?" I said, "Not really." He said, gives us all kinds of instructions. And he says, "There's a door there. It's kind of a, you know, it's not terribly pretentious. Just make sure you, you know, just kind of watch if somebody's heading up there. You guys go on up." I said, "But should anybody know about that? Don't worry about this. Don't worry about it." So here we are, three guys from Perth County. We're trucking along like this as if we're going up into the press box of Maple Leaf Gardens. And we find the door, and there's a guy standing beside the door, fairly protective, like this. And it was Stan Avodiak. And Avodiak was known for a lot of things. In fact, you know, when he was the world championship team in 51 with Lethbridge. But he was also known to be fiercely loyal to the Leafs and Ballard, and he was there 26 years at the Gardens. So he was chatting with somebody, and the door was open, and we kind of walked up the door and made half a step forward, and all of a sudden the door slammed shut, and he's on the hand. He says, "Where are you guys going?" I said, "Well, we were watching the game for press box." "I don't think so." "Well, all I'm saying is that's what we were told." "Who told?" "King Clancy." Door opened, up we went. So we watched the Leafs lose, I think, 8-3 to Philly that night. But anyway, the very next weekend, it's down to Montreal. And we go down to Montreal, and I had some interviews lined up there, but not until noon hour on the Saturday. It's exactly a week later. We roll into town, the Bruins are in town. This is the year, you remember, when the Canadiens lost just 8 games in the entire season. And by this time, they've lost 7, and I think 3 of those 7 have been against the Bruins. We get in, and the Bruins were in town that night. We get into town, and we've got some time to kill before noon hour. I said, "Well, let's go down to Forum. Let's just see if we can get in down there and get some morning skate stuff." This is all black and white stuff, heavy camera. So we drive around to the back of the Forum. There's a back door that's open, but partly open, but then there's a big screen door, like a big metal gate, I guess, a huge metal gate. I think it's so if they park the gate, they can drive heavy equipment in there if they had to, something fairly large. So we see this gate, and we're standing there, and obviously we're not going anywhere, but I could see through one of the aisles, one of the openings, that there were skaters out there. There were, you know, air pucks going on to, you know, echoing as they bounced back and forth. And a little guy came over to us, a little Quebecois guy, Mr. Canadian, and he said to us, basically, "What are you guys doing here?" Now this was difficult. Here I am trying to explain that we're 3 guys from Stratford, we're down here, we're trying to do a documentary on Howie Marin, we're wondering if we can get some footage of the warm-up Saturday morning. Well, this wasn't registering too much. He just wasn't identifying that this at all. He understood what I was saying, and he was speaking pretty good English. I said it a couple of times, and then he goes, "You, come with me." So he left me in, and then he closed the gate and left the other 2 guys out there. So we walked, and this is a story about small rooms in arenas. We walked out, again, we're underneath the seats in the Forum, and again, he finds this small room. It's even smaller than the one in Toronto. There's a desk, a chair on this side of the desk, a chair on this side of the desk, and a lamp. And that was about it. There's no room for a fish tank in this room. So he gets on the phone, and he phones, and he's speaking French, and I have no idea what he's saying. None. And he's partway through this conversation, and then he goes, hands the phone to me, and I grab the receiver, and I say, "Monsieur Pellibault." So I didn't have time to get frightened. I just said hello, and he said, "I understand." He had the drift. The guy had it down really well. I didn't think he understood what we were doing. He said, "I understand." One thing he had wrong, he said, "Bellibo said, I understand you guys want to see the game tonight." I said, no, we didn't. You know, we didn't come here to do that, but." And then, but before I could even say goodbye, he said, "The press box is pretty full tonight. Sports Illustrated's here, you know, a lot of people from Boston. Pretty important game," and da 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 da. I said, "Yeah, no, I understand. I was having trouble finding the words. And he said, "I'll tell you what, you phone back at 4 o'clock and ask for Camille Laroche, and he will he'll let you know whether you can stay for the game." Okay, merci. We didn't get in to see any of the practice. I saw a bit of it, but then went up and got the guys. We go down Place Tavern, which I didn't know was part of the convent building was there. And we were to be told that somewhere around lunch, we said we'd keep it out at lunch. So long, deep, narrow bar, tavern, with just wall after wall after wall of photographs. It was a perfect spot. And it was crowded. It was Saturday, it was a hot day, it was crowded. The bartender comes over and I told him we were here to see the play. And he said, just a minute. So he goes way to the back, comes all the way back, and he says, come with me. So again, not the other two, just me. Walks me the full length of the bar. The other guys are busy looking at all the photographs anyway. I go back in, there's Toby, stands up, shakes my hand. We introduce each other because we corresponded by mail, letters. And he said, you know, he says, there's a game tonight. He says, I usually go home right after lunch and have a nap. Is there any chance we could do the interview before the game? And I said, well, yeah, we can do that, but where do we have to meet you, or how does that work? So he told me, he said, this is a certain game you go around to, and it'll be, you know, you just ask for me. Okay. And so we left. We kind of think, well, we haven't lost this interview. And then we headed on down to Andy O'Brien's condominium. And he was living there by himself. Invites us in. Just a great guy. I'm sure there were some of the guys in here knew Andy O'Brien, but he was just terrific. And I remember as a paper boy, when I was this high, delivering the paper in the London Free Press, the heavy sucker on Saturdays, because it had Weekend magazine in it. But the first thing I did before I even delivered the paper was flip open Weekend magazine and see what hockey player Andy O'Brien was profiled on the page. And there were always pictures of Bobby Hull and, you know, and all these guys. So, I mean, this was it was incredible. He invites us in. We have a great interview. He was relaxed as could be, sitting on his couch, smoking a cigar, and answering our questions. And then he said, I think we pretty well got it here, Andy, unless there's anything else you've got. So he said, well, what do you boys like that? Like scotch. Well, all right. And then I looked at my watch and I thought, and I told him the situation. I said, I'm supposed to phone the forum and see if we can get in to see the game tonight. He said, when's the bedroom? Just phone in there. It's private. I'm just going to call. So I went in and called, and DeRoche is on the line, and I asked for him. He gets on, he says, yeah, well, there are three places for you in the press box. Come to such and such a gate, and there'll be somebody there to meet you and look after you. Okay. So we have our drink with Andy, and it was terrific. We got great stuff. Back up, we leave, we get back, we go for something, we get back down to the forum in time to go around, which is barely time we did the interview before. And I told DeRoche that we were hoping to do late. I know that. So we go to the appointed gate, and who's there to be our host for the night? Joe Blake. He meets us at the gate, he says, come on in, here with me. So we walk in, I said, he said, I can take this press box, I'll look after you. I said, where can we do the interview? He said, I can find a room.